games are the latest craze to sweep the country and most of the world, too.
Pac-Man, Ms. Pac-Man, Space Invaders, Defenders, and Asteroids.
Finish him. I'll be back.
It's alive! It's alive!
Round one.
Are you afraid of God?
No. I'm afraid of the
Hungry
Gamers!
Hello, 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 and welcome, boys and girls, to the 55th episode of the Hungry Gamers podcast. We are powered by 8bit.net and Audio Technica, and I'm your not-so-humble host, Brendan White. Find me everywhere at Brendan8bit. As per usual, I'm joined by my two partners in crime here, Reese Kirby, who can be found at Reese8bit, Sam Abraham, who can be found at Salim Abraham. G'day, brothers. How you doing today?
I am experiencing peak tranquility as I have entered the podcast at peak coffee. I'm shaking right now. They put something in my coffee.
You are over 9,000 right now.
They put something in my coffee and I'm like...
You do a mocha with three equals.
Yeah.
Plus you've eaten some choc chip cookies and you've just cracked some P-Max.
I'm all about equality.
Yes. Yeah. So you are on the highest of highs right now.
I'm all about equality.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because I have three equals.
Of course. Okay.
Oh, that's terrible, but we'll give that to you.
I'll pay it.
Doing great. I'm doing awesome. How about you, Sam?
I'm good. I'm the complete opposite end of the spectrum.
Oh, right.
He needs some equals.
I need something.
Pour some equal in that water there.
Locked up and
a bit of chili. Do some chili flavored ramen. That'll sort you out.
That'll sort me right out.
It's a nice shirt. You're like the Lebanese Steve Irwin.
It's like he's come out of Uncharted.
Yeah.
Like he's just finished an expedition getting a gold title.
It's very practical. It's got two breast pockets.
Yes. What would you put in those two breast pockets?
A grenade.
Winfield Blues in the left.
Yep.
Winfield Reds in the right.
Yeehaw.
The Cowboys die.
That's a man with a plan right there. So it is the 55th episode, and I got to backtrack to start with and say I am sorry. It is three hellos to start with.
Well, this was a
thank you.
Of contention.
It was
point
last
of conjecture
week.
Last week.
Yeah. I was adamant and then I listened to it and then I listened to a few others and I was just like, damn it, they got me. And I was even debating doing four hellos to offset the one from last week.
Well,
to say
to
I
now.
Owe that to episode 54.
That would have just been chaos. That would have
I know. The world ain't ready for four hellos.
There would have been just a stretch in time.
Hello, 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 and welcome. You'd sound very
good. Starting to sound like the Cat Empire.
Yeah.
Hello, hello.
No.
I think we slandered that band last week too,
didn't
we?
We did.
Yeah, every week. I came out for them though. They did the Giants, anyway. They did the Giants song, victory song, which I'm not going to sing again.
Nah, please don't. Please don't. So we're here 55 times. It's all happening. It's a nice sunny day here in Sydney for the first time in about 15 years, it feels like.
Yeah, I'm waiting for that winter so I can have an excuse not to go outside.
I'm already getting the change of weather, sick.
Oh, so that's sort of what's ailing you at the moment, you reckon.
Yeah, that's this.
The climate change.
Sleeping with my window open and the cold air comes in.
There's half
the
problem.
Hit with old sun on the way in now.
Little sort of segue into sleeping. We've now put silk pillows on the bed.
I can't get behind that. I'm sorry.
Tried it out last night. Holy moly, it is fantastic.
Like
my head
linen?
Is slipping and sliding and staying cool.
No slipping and sliding. Reese Kirby likes to be in one position when he sleeps.
But isn't that like a very summer pillow?
I don't know.
Oh fuck that. That would just be worse. It'd just be like a sweaty, slidey.
It'll be good in winter time, I guess, because it's that general coolness from the silk.
The cotton's what you want in winter.
I have a question. Duck feather or normal sort of?
I've got duck feather.
Yeah, you've got to have the duck feather.
Yeah.
So you can mold.
But we've actually, we just bought a goose down quilt from Adair's.
Got it
like half off. Super expensive.
What
still.
Is it?
I don't understand.
Quilt?
Yeah, it's goose feathers, which is obviously the evolved form of the duck. So
it evolves into?
Yeah.
Once it reaches
science.
Level 15.
It's science, you know.
Yeah.
Okay. We haven't tried it yet, but this blanket,
Well, we've actually got the
insane.
Pterodactyl feathers.
Damn it.
So, you know.
They would only have a couple, thank you very much. I know science has proven that they did have some plumage.
We just took that many feathers from that many pterodactyls that we made an entire blanket.
So there was no big asteroid. It was Kerbo's ancestors coming in just plucking pterodactyls, and that was the end of the dinosaurs.
Handed down from generation to generation.
I single-handedly shaped the evolution of that particular animal, because now they are amphibious and drag their asses along the ground. In fact, they've actually been renamed.
Did they just see you doing that? No, like,
because the evolution has come so far, they no longer have legs, so they change the name from pterodactyl to the umadoodle bird, because when they land, they just go umadoodle, umadoodle, umadoodle.
I don't know where to go.
I like the effort and the setup of this, but come on now. Come on. So they're legless birds that have wings.
Yeah. And when they land, because they make that sound, that's why they got their name, the umadoodle bird.
What about the female ones? What do you call them?
Well, see, the females tend to stay on the land because they nest on the land.
The Hungry Gamers podcast. Right here on 8bit.net.
We always go, we go well when we start talking about animals.
It's those three equals that just got you fast and loose.
All about equality.
I'm still piecing that last joke together. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, man, I'm a regular, you know, CK, Louis, what's his name?
Louis CK.
I'm a really funny guy.
Yes.
Super smart.
Mm.
I'm a Bill Burr. Nah, I don't want to be Bill Burr. It's far too sexist.
You're more like Bobcat Goldthwait.
Oh, I love Bob. Okay, so have you ever listened to Bobcat Goldthwait outside of him doing the voice on Police Academy?
No.
Super intelligent guy, really funny, knows his comedy, like, just talks normally, talks like I'm talking now.
Yeah, he directs a lot of stuff.
He's absolutely fantastic. If you're out there, Bobcat, hope you're doing all right.
Got a nod from old Turbo.
Got a nod from me, mate. It's love your work.
Keep up the good work, Chief.
Keep it up. Speaking of good work, what have you been doing this week?
I have been knee-deep in the Bolivian jungle.
Oh, watch out.
Taking out
watch
some,
out. You're going to get a bloody court case thrown at you in a minute.
Yeah. Just, you know, taking out some drug dealers / cartels in Ghost Recon Wildlands.
Very cool.
So
tell us about it.
I,
pros, cons.
I spoke a little bit about the multiplayer last week. Yep. You know, everybody's been across that. Obviously, this week I'm focusing on the single player. Okay, I mentioned that I read a lot of reviews. I can see where the reviews are coming from, because if you were closed-minded about it, you could say that this is a Watch Dogs 2 reskin.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Because you've got an open world, different sort of areas, if you will, that have enemies, and you have a drone that you can level up and down, and you have to sort of enter stealthily and take out the enemies, and you upgrade your weapons as you go, and... It's kind of, you know, like that. You've got
there
story missions, side
missions. There is a lot of comparisons
missions.
Going around that it's like The Division mixed with Watch Dogs.
Yeah.
Mixed with Just Cause.
I can sort of the main three that I keep seeing
getting ponied around.
I can definitely sympathize with that point of view. But
that's three great games.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's why I say it's worth picking up. I wouldn't spend $100 on it, and I didn't.
Of course you didn't.
Yeah, thanks to the old... special shout out to my friend, manager at EB Games, Westfield Sydney. She price matched Target online, whereas the gallery store does not price match Target. So I just want that to be clear.
Throw on some gallery
shade. That's a fucking travesty.
EB Games, Sydney City will price match Target. Galleries will not. Anyway,
go.
I got Ghost Recon for $59, so I was pretty happy about that.
That's a good steal.
So
$59, also Zelda Breath of the Wild and Horizon Zero Dawn available online via Target 2.
True.
Get
so,
on that shit if it's still available as of recording.
If it's a advertised price online, EB Games Sydney City will match it. Okay, back to Ghost Recon. So the real fun that I was having is, as you mentioned, you rightfully predicted... you saw this as a game that you're really only going to have fun with if you're playing with friends, which is 100% true. I find that if you play Watch Dogs 2 with friends, it's not really...
Yeah, because there's less reliance in Watch Dogs 2 on the multiplayer aspect.
You know,
you can pop in, pop out, but it's mostly a single-player created universe where there's active NPCs you can interact with.
Exactly, but Ghost Recon Wildlands is a different ballgame in the sense that it's team-based tactical stealth espionage combat. So one of my good friends picked it up as well, and we played it, and because we're both kind of really into that, you know,
that
Navy SEAL
teamwork
based we
action.
Take it very seriously. So we were like,
that's
using
the best.
Code names and correct, you know, alpha Bravo, Tango, that whole thing, and just not even questioning or laughing about it. It's like, this is serious.
Very
business.
Deadpan stuff.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Can I ask, what are your character names? Like, I'm assuming, knowing you, you've gone full in and you've got a character with a backstory and a.
Well, I mean, my ongoing character is Dogpatch06.
Okay.
Who, you know, was an active member of SEAL Team 6 during the 90s and, you know, is just doing mercenary work for money. Mm.
Gotta get that paper.
Yeah, you know, so my constituent, Dirt Diver, he was helping out on a mission and we were taking over just a small mansion. And it was intense, man, because, like, I got into it.
Would you call a small mansion just a house? When does a mansion become a mansion?
That's
or...
a great question,
Brendan.
You know what I'm saying?
That's do a I really, need to remind you really about the coffee question. Peaking? Because I am literally seeing through time.
You right are now. Gotten twitchy eye going.
He's
on
hearing colour. Right now.
Please do not ruin my brain.
Okay.
So yeah, we got very into it, and see, the thing with the Ghost Recon Wildlands is that you can, if you're seen, they send reinforcements, and if they send reinforcements, you're kind of fucked because there's two.
Yeah, it's no good.
Two jeeps of guys pull up, right, and usually the guys in the jeeps get
do
out.
They have a gunner, like
yeah.
a gun.
Yeah, they get out of the jeeps and they walk around, and they, you know what I mean. This particular Those occasion. Jeeps. The jeeps pulled up and the guys just stayed there. Oh. They were blocking the exit of where we needed to go.
Oh,
so
tactics.
We skillfully headed over to a surrounding building and stood on top of the building and each lobbed a grenade at the exact same time. And both the jeeps blew up with the guys inside. That was very cool. Mm. I definitely felt like...
was there like a digital high five exchange after that? Like you and Dirt Diver just went, you know what? We got this.
It's more of a single nod, you know, okay. just because you don't want to like.
Can you do emotes in this game? Like, can you do that? Like, you know, in Division and stuff, you had like you
I don't know
wave
about online,
and stuff. I wonder if you could sort of do that happen, then like give them like a salute across the battlefield. I think that'd be awesome.
The other thing we were doing is that we were using tactics in the sense that he was the sniper keeping watch up above.
Okay,
and I was the ground sort of close quarters MP5 guy, so he'd be like, all right, three tangos in front of you, you know, 3 o'clock, 5 o'clock, send out smoke, whatever. And that made the game incredibly fun for me. So I want to throw this out there. I was thinking about getting this game on PC as well.
Ooh.
And doing a true to form role play server, meaning you need a character,
I love
you need
this
a backstory,
idea.
You need a voice, if you will. An accent for some, maybe, Sam. This could be your thing.
Could be my thing.
And you must stay in character
I love
the whole
accents.
Time.
Can I'm throwing it at you right now? Would it? Can you include like permadeath, like in typical other recon games,
wow,
where say us three and Dirt Diver roll out into a match, one of us gets gunned down by the cartel.
You just took
I'm
this
done.
Great idea and fucking dialed it up to 11.
Yeah,
well,
then I'm done.
It. I mean, permadeath. I think would definitely need to be a standard because when you're playing and you're in a fight and you get shot and you get downed, you can be revived once per fight.
Yeah, like
right,
in
okay.
like in the Division.
Right? So that's a good feature. So if you're down only once you're in a fight, that's okay. But I think permadeath could be a thing. I think that's a good element.
I think
it
we should make this happen, yeah.
So look, I'm throwing it out there, people. If you want to be a part of it, get us on Discord.
Yes.
Hit us up if you like the idea. If there's more than four people that want to do it, then maybe we can run a different, you know, schedule or something. So, all in
I
all,
like the idea.
Fantastic game.
Yeah,
I
you
love
sound
it.
Like you love this game.
How's the I see that there's a pretty in-depth character customization.
Yes, you definitely got like all aspects of the character can be modified.
Your character did look very much like you, by the way.
Yeah, that was just lucky because I could find the hair. I mean, not the body, obviously, because I'm much more chiseled.
Yeah,
than
you're
that,
more but, Adonis.
Yeah, but I'm like lean. Like I've got a good core.
Yeah, you're good. Swift running in the Bolivian
agile
landscape.
Yeah, he's
a
bit bulky, but yeah, the customization on it is fantastic. Look, if you're a single player that doesn't really like playing with other people or whatever. Might not be the game for you.
How did you find the like your team AI? Like were they pretty
God.
Intuitive or are
no.
you constantly almost holding their hand saying, go here,
it's,
shoot that guy,
it can be
do
frustrating.
This.
I don't really think anyone's really nailed. The only time I felt like my AI team is really behind me is SOCOM 3. Because 1 and 2 didn't really get it. SOCOM 3.
PS2 days?
Yeah. But this particular AI, Yeah. I often had to, I guess, hold their hand through a lot of things because they were getting seen. They were, I'd tell them to go, if there's two routes, I tell them to take the west route, I go the east.
So you'd always go sort of solo and you just send the posse down that way?
Or? Yeah, yeah. Because I'll spot them or they'll spot me or whatever.
Because you are ex-SEAL Team 6 and these guys are just lowly noobs.
Yeah, you know? Well, you know, I've got to show the kids a lesson.
Yeah, fresh straight recruits. Out of the academy.
Very green, very green. Yeah. So, yeah. But they would go halfway down the route and then just stop. Or, you know, I would get into a car and they would take like 6 years to get down the mountain just to... Yeah, but look, if you play with friends, amazing game. Yeah. Definitely worth playing. I love it.
Because you're on Xbox One right now.
I am on Xbox One.
Yeah,
which no one...
I was debating jumping on Xbox One because you've got two guys on there, right? Obviously, yourself and
just
Dirt
me
Diver.
And Dirt Diver. So
it's four-man teams.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at you over the table here, Mr. Abraham.
Oh,
we
look.
Could become the third and fourth members of this team.
We could, yeah. I'm not in possession of my Xbox at the moment.
Oh, that's right. You've lent it out.
We might have to do some hazing, but I think it can work out.
Damn it.
I'm sure you'll find a fourth. Mm. Ali, does Ali have an Xbox?
Yeah.
I don't know if this game might be an Ali game. I don't know. She likes H1Z1. It's got that feel to it, I guess.
Well, we all thought she'd be a HCD person, and she said she wasn't. So she surprised us there. She might surprise us again.
There you go.
Otherwise, I'll just get that Xbox back.
So, yeah, I love that game. That's what I've been playing. I went and saw Logan last night.
Oh,
we already spoke about it last week. Fucking probably the best movie I've ever seen since Deadpool, hands down. Every superhero movie should
Deadpool.
Be
R-rated. I think it's better than Deadpool. 100%.
To me, they're different.
Deadpool is
a comedy movie, and Logan is a proper, like, dramatic action movie.
Yes.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah.
I've reflected on Logan a lot this week, and my opinion still stays the same. Like, it is amazing. I loved everything about it, and I want to go watch it again in the next week or so, because that cinema experience was second to none.
I saw the trailer for Ghost in the Shell. Well, I didn't. I purposefully looked away from the trailer because
the trailers don't look too bad
for Ghost in the Shell.
Well, you haven't seen any of them.
Well,
I've
seen
them
bits
out.
And pieces, but I hate how they reveal so much of the movie now.
There wasn't
just,
another one yet, was there?
Yeah, yeah.
This week, Monday, Tuesday.
There's a one that I saw at the movie that went for like 3 minutes.
Yeah.
Oh.
And they were showing a lot of stuff.
But
so,
it's the same as the original anime movie, isn't it? Same story.
Yes, but the difference being is that with the Ghost in the Shell movie anime, they thrust you into the world with zero explanation. So they understand what's happening, but you have to piece it together. Mm. So that leaves open a lot of fan theories and things like that.
Yeah, that's not going to happen.
What I see in the movie, you know, I don't crucify them for this because they've got to make it open for audiences and what have you, is that they explain everything.
Yeah,
they explain,
it's got to be accessible to generate money.
Yeah, so, you know, I see why they're doing that, and I don't hold them accountable for that. So, look, I will go and watch it. I know I said I probably wouldn't.
The special
effects,
look, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
That's also the sort of position they take, or, like, that's the sort of thing they did with the later Ghost in the Shell movies and
the
series,
second movies,
right? Like, Standalone Complex. There was tons of, like,
I love
scenes of Kusanagi just, like, reflecting on what she is, what is life, blah, blah, blah. And there's definitely like one scene in the trailer for Ghost in the Shell, the movie that's coming out, where she's like kissing this woman.
Yeah.
And they're like, what are you?
Yeah.
You know? Mm. So yeah, you're right.
So that comes out at the end of this month.
So I'll go
I'm
and see
so
that.
I'm so keen, man.
Yeah.
I'm so
we'll
keen.
Go watch that.
March is just a great month.
March is really delivered so far.
Horizon Zero Dawn, Ghost Recon Wildlands, Nintendo Switch with Zelda, Logan, bloody Power Rangers comes out in a week. Ghost in the Shell comes out shortly. Even the new live-action Beauty and the Beast film I'm keen to see. It's a fucking great month, people. Kudos to March. Kudos to March. Sam, what have you been doing?
I've been playing, just to kick off from Reese's high energy and explosive combat and action, I too have been playing high-stakes, explosive action in the world of Yu-Gi-Oh!
Ooh.
Duel Links. Yeah.
I downloaded this game, but I haven't played it because I see a lot of cult status about it. So
let me tell you all about it, friend.
Strap yourselves in, listeners.
I don't know if I hate it or not. I'm not sure.
That's not a good opening statement.
No, it's not a great opening statement.
I'm very confused.
So, Yu-Gi-Oh is the card game. We all know and love it. You activated my trap card, right? We all know it. I played it, like, the video games before, like the Yu-Gi-Oh ones that used to be on, like, Game Boy. Get the ROMs. And it's the same game. It's the same card game, but they've stripped it back a little bit.
And just reskinned it for phone.
Yeah, pretty much. So what they've done is they've just halved it. So there used to be, like, when you'd play a normal game, you would have your life points, which is about 8,000, and you would have 5 zones where you could play cards. They've limited it to 3 and 4,000 life points, but they haven't changed any of the cards. So there's a lot of cards that now aren't playable because it just doesn't make sense to play them. My problem with Yu-Gi-Oh! Is that it always has 10,000 cards and 9,990 of them are shit. And so you just want them
10 cards.
You just want the 10 cards. Mm. And I think I've played 15 hours probably of this week. Yeah, like a stupid amount of time I've put into it. It's not like Hearthstone either. You know how Hearthstone's just straight PvP and then they've got the solo content. Mm. This is more solo oriented and you can do PvP if you want to.
Oh.
And the problem with the solo is that the AI shit.
So you just roll.
Roll them. Smash through them. And then the PvP, you just get smashed because someone's put $300 into the game.
Mm. So this is pay to win.
It's not quite pay to win because there's like, I mean, of course, there's an in-game currency. It's freemium. But you have no chance. Like, I think I've cracked 30 or 40 packs and the deck I've got is not the best. It's enough to smash the AI, but that's about it. But for some reason, I can't stop playing. So I don't know if it's good or not.
Okay.
Not great. Made by Konami, so definitely don't put any money into it.
Yeah, because we all still have an axe to grind with Konami.
That's right, after they...
We got you back, Adeo.
Double-crossed good friend of ours, good friends of the podcast, and certainly mentor of all of ours, Hideo Kojima.
Who pseudo-felt your ass heat.
Pseudo-felt, yeah, there's got to be a term for that. Mm. I don't know what it shake. Is.
Butt osmosis.
Instead of a handshake, it's a butt shake.
It's a butt shake.
I don't understand what happened.
Butt shook.
Sam did the dirtiest poo at all of RTX. And 2 seconds after he got off the toilet seat, went out, Hideo went straight in and sat down on that warm toilet seat.
Oh.
Yeah, have I not told you that story?
No, I didn't know that. Mm. That's fun.
It's pretty bad, man.
Yeah.
It was pretty fun.
Just reminds me of that meme that talks about when men go into the bathroom and they sit down on the toilet. And it's like what it looks like, a man sitting on a toilet. And what it feels like is that one man sitting and another man directly underneath him, like sitting ass to ass. And that's what it does feel like. Every time I sit down on a warm toilet seat, that's the meme I think of. I'm sitting on another man's ass.
Well, imagine like that same image, but instead of the two nondescript figures, you have me, nude. Think about it.
And then you have Hideo
Kojima as the other ass. That's what happened, guys.
This needs
you
to be a tattoo.
You touched the ass of God.
This needs to be a tattoo.
It was so funny, man, because I saw him on stage on the Saturday, and I was just like in awe of the interview that like he was giving. And I was just like, I was listening to the things he was saying and the stories he was telling. I'm like, this guy's amazing. Like, this guy's inspiring. He's a god. He's done so much. And then, like, the next day, I've just got a really great shit story. Like, to do with the same guy.
Me and Hideo touch butts.
Touch butts. Yeah. Anyway, fuck Konami. Don't put any money into any Konami games. But play this one for free. I don't even feel the need to spend money on this game. That's the other crazy thing. Like, I've never really limited unless I play PvP. And I don't need
If you
to.
Want another card-based game on your phone, Elder Scrolls Legend is now available on iOS and I think Android as well, as of Friday.
Really?
Mm.
Well, I did give
It's
that
good
a,
fun to play.
I did give that a try, yeah. I played it when
Sadly,
it was...
Sadly, I haven't touched it again in months. I think I've got it on the surface here. I haven't touched it in months.
I think it's the same reason I don't put money into anything else anymore. It's just I've put too much into Hearthstone. So I have to be a Hearthstone guy now for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
You've made
your bed.
Just to justify the stupid amount of money that's
You've
gone.
Made your bed in Kazakhstan or whatever it's called.
In Ungaro.
In Ungaro. Yeah. That's the new one coming
that's
up, right?
That's the new one coming out, yeah.
I'm hip.
Very fun. Yeah, you know. Mm. You're not old hat.
Nah. Nah, certainly not.
Mate, what are you doing? What have you been doing?
The quest for the Horizon Zero Dawn Platinum is still going strong.
Wow.
I've got two trophies to go.
How many hours?
I'm near 50.
Okay.
Near 50 hours.
I feel like you were near 50 last week.
Nah, I haven't put a ton of time, because I've been playing a lot of Zelda this week. So I've put maybe another 6 hours into Horizon this week. I still love that game so much. It is the perfect game for me. I know I've said that a lot.
Yeah.
I don't need to dwell on that.
Every
know.
Time you
we
say
know.
Horizon Zero Dawn, like for the rest of your life, you reflect on it. You say, Horizon Zero Dawn, by the way, perfect game for me.
Yeah. Like if I ever meet the guys from Guerrilla or whatnot, I'll be like, you made this game for me. It feels like. I know, obviously, they didn't, but like.
You could have met that guy at that thing we went to.
I know. Where was I? Queensland.
Yeah.
Damn it.
Yeah.
Curse the 9 to 5. Anyway.
the 11 till 2.
That was a weird event, by the way.
I love that event. That
we
amazing.
Got way too drunk and did archery.
Doesn't matter.
That
doesn't
shouldn't
matter.
Have happened. Mm. I was
you had war paint on? Like
I was worried by how fast like the bolt or
the arrow
like hits the target. I didn't. I thought it was just.
Was that your first
flinty.
Time ever firing a bow?
First time in recent history, yeah. Like, I think the last time was like.
Were camp. They compound bows?
I'm going to say yes. Compound meaning.
Compound bow, usually you'll feel a ton of resistance when you're drawing the bow back, and then you get to a certain point, it'll loosen up, and then you can sort of cock it a little bit further.
They weren't that advanced.
No. I think, yeah, they really wanted to limit.
Because you can do a lot of fucking damage with a bow and arrow, so I doubt they'd give you some heavy, heavy duty stuff.
Those bows they've got now with the wheels and shit on them, they're intense.
That they serve beer and then did that.
Oh, it's fantastic.
I think it was a great gamble.
That's on them, though. Like, that's not my problem.
Oh, yeah, they made us sign shitty waivers. I was signing it like, this shit isn't going to hold up yet.
Smiley face.
Just wrote a fake alias on there and everything.
Yeah. So, nice. Okay, Horizon Zero Dawn, in case you didn't know, is the perfect game.
$59. So good. I love it so damn much.
$59?
Yeah, on Target Online.
Oh, sure, okay.
Yeah, so it's... I don't know if it's still running, but yeah, via the Target Online store, Horizon Zero Dawn, Zelda Breath of the Wild, Wildlands, and I think one or two other recent releases, Resident Evil 7, I think was the same, all $59. So now's the time, if you've got some pennies put aside and you want some new games,
okay,
get on that. But yeah, I've been getting lost in Zelda Breath of the Wild.
Can you explain this to me?
So Zelda Breath, like, I guess the really brief narrative of it is... You play Link, you wake up 100 years later in this resurrection chamber. You've lost your memories. You don't know what's been happening, and slowly but surely, you meet characters. You piece it all together. But the real brief description is: Calamity Ganon has taken over and destroyed Hyrule. Zelda has been fighting him for like 100 years. You've just been in this resurrection chamber, having a kip, rebuilding yourself for 100 years. Then you've got to come back and reunite Hyrule and do battle against Calamity to try and obviously take Hyrule back and make it great again.
Okay.
But...
Make Hyrule great again.
It's such...
Everyone's got little hats.
little red trucker hats on.
Some little prick at the top there with bad tans. Yeah, I got them. Ganon. It'd be Ganon for sure.
But this game, to me at times, is so overwhelming. You almost stop and go, I can't play this right now because there's zero hand-holding. There's no, here's this quest you have to go. Like,
oh,
obviously,
wonderful.
There's main quests that you obviously have to plot together to eventually take down Ganon.
Mm.
But you've got the entire map open to you right from the get-go. So you could run, or if you catch a horse, ride the horse all the way to the furthest point of the map. And you could do battle with all kinds of enemies along the way. But there's no way to determine how strong or weak said enemies are. So a lot of the times I'll just be trucking around Hyrule and then I'll see an enemy like, oh, I'll take this down. Then one shot, I'm dead. And it's like, fuck, okay, maybe I need some more tactic. Not that tactic. No, one shot, I'm dead. Okay, got to go back, regroup, go do a couple of shrines, get my heart level up higher, so on and so forth. So it's literally open world, open mind, do whatever you want.
So if there was ever anyone... If you ask me who is the most open world RPG loving person ever, I have to say it's you.
Yeah.
Because you're a Witcher person. You are of the Horizon Zero Dawn
persuasion
now.
Yep.
So when you say this is too big, what specifically, or overwhelming, when you say this is too overwhelming, is it that you don't understand what you're doing at each point. Like when you talk about these enemies,
there's a bit of that.
The hand holding.
I think there's a lot of like one of the like the little axes I've got to grind on it. It's minor. Like this game's amazing. Like Nintendo have hit it out of the park. With
it's 10 out of 10.
Yeah, like you see, like it's universal flawless scores from everywhere.
Yeah.
But doing side quests and everything, like I love running around locations in RPGs and you meet this person, they go, oh, help me with this or go fight that. And cool. So you go do these side quests, but you don't get XP. So you don't, there's no progression system within the game apart from doing these shrines that you can then level up your health or your stamina, really.
Right. Okay. Yeah, but that's pretty standard for a Zelda game.
Yeah, it's standard, but like...
And then you unlock more weapons as you go as well.
You pick up weapons as you go, but like, they're so brittle. So often you're picking up weapons, whether it be swords and whatnot. Earlier in the game, obviously it's more regular. Later in the game, they've got a little bit more strength and a little bit more durability.
Right,
but you'll be fighting enemies sometimes, and you'll be like, with your broadsword or whatever, and like, swing, 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 your sword is damaged. Swing, swing, your sword breaks. Shit, I got to quickly jump into my menu, grab another weapon on the fly. So you're constantly juggling between weapons because you're breaking things, you're picking up sticks, like in the low levels especially.
Yeah.
You're picking up bloody tree branches and fighting your way with that or...
that would annoy me.
Or bats and things. So I think they probably could have dialed out the lifespan on some of the weapons a little bit more. Obviously, as I said, later in the piece, like I think I'm about somewhere between maybe 15 to 20 hours in now, and I've noticed the durability... pain points from the first say five to ten hours aren't as apparent, but it's still noticeable sometimes, especially when you've got a sword. Like swords are designed obviously to see you through battles for decades in combat, you know. So fighting one enemy and then having it break, you're just like, oh, fuck. You know, that was the best sword I had, now it's gone. Now I'm fighting this dude with a shitty staff that I just picked up 5 minutes ago. Like it's
weird.
But I like that. Like there is that good element of risk reward. You got to be very calculated with your weapons, especially using your bow and things like that.
Yeah, we're gonna have a hell of a time playing Minecraft together soon.
Oh yeah, yeah. That'll
if
probably
you hate that there. You're gonna loathe it in Minecraft, but
yeah, but just the sheer scope of this game and just little things that I'll be doing in the game. I'll just sit back and go, holy fuck, this is so well put together. The asset management in it, like. One example, I'm running around, obviously you've got your Sheikah Slate, which is like, it's almost like a Zelda inspired Switch or smartphone, right? So this thing is your map, you go into it and it's your inventory management, you can pinpoint areas, you can use it as sort of like a set of binoculars, it's your little go-to cyber Swiss Army knife, right?
Sheikah Slate,
that's the thing, and like this is the device of like legendary warriors, so you roll in, you meet NPCs, like, oh! Got the Sheikah Slate, you know, you're a bit of a big deal rolling around with this thing on your hip.
Oh yeah.
And
what kind of case does it have?
It's like black and orange.
See, I get a better case than that.
Yeah. I haven't found
just go on the eBay inside.
The servers are down in there, the wireless connection in Hyrule is not too good. A lot of valleys. Low down.
Well, just
in there,
don't buy them
so
from those kiosks, because they charge like $40 for a piece of plastic.
Yeah.
It's so ridiculous.
But there was this one thing, I was running around some area in the map and it starts raining, right? And I needed to get from point A to point B to get to this hut to pick up some stuff. And I'm running. The rain is falling down. Weather effects are great. The rain starts hitting the Sheikah Slate and it starts sparking. And at first I'm like, what the fuck? Anyway, I'm still running. Then obviously because this is an electrical based device and it's sparking and whatnot, and there's a thunderstorm. So lightning's crashing all around. Then lightning, whack, hits me. Fucking instant death. I'm like, fuck, okay, whatever. That's probably just a random one-off thing. Started again, running. Obviously, it's electrical product, gets wet again, starts conducting, zap. So I'm like, okay, this is smart. This is like, you know, dynamic weather effects playing into what I'm wearing, So I waited out in this like decrepit church until the rain subsides and I run out and it's all fine.
What do you have to do the whole time? Like, how long are you waiting?
I had to wait a couple of minutes. Like,
so
it was legitimate.
So what were you doing?
Sitting. Literally sitting there.
Pondering.
Fucking really?
Yeah.
But the odds of you getting struck by lightning more than once, like, I don't know, seems a little bit unrealistic, especially since lightning is conducted to the highest point from the ground. I don't know.
Was sort of on a hill. Like, I guess because this thing is an electrical-based device and there's not many of them in this realm, I don't know. There's logic there somewhere, but I was just impressed by that little thing. Another one.
It does sound cool. That sounds like, all right.
I'm running around with, obviously, you've got torches with fire. And I'm sort of skulking around, and then there's a group of enemies. So I sort of crouch in the grass to hide. And because I've got a torch with fire on it, the fucking grass around me caught fire. So then I'm getting burnt hiding in this like big thing of grass. So I'm rolling out of there, but because I've still got this torch with fire, I'm rolling out, just creating further and further fire. So I end up throwing this torch away and just ran out and watched this burn down this whole forest area. Sort of things like that. Like, it's so well calculated and thought out where the environment is destructible and it reacts to how you play. You can use your sword to sort of cut down the grass. Then you can collect insects and stuff out of there to then cook to make potions and buffs and things like that. So it's...
Could they not see you with your torch?
They could have. I didn't get a fiery torch. Yeah, I didn't get close. Like, I wasn't like meter away. Like, I was sort of, you know, maybe 30 meters back, and they had their back turned to me, so it was all right. But just little things like that. I sit there and I go, this is so well thought out. Like, every little piece of this game universe is put there for a reason. Yeah. It feels like it's not just here's some filler, here's a nice space to hide or whatever. It's like, depending on what you do in there, the whole universe will change accordingly. And
as time goes on, when they get more and more updates, more things like that will probably be added, I'm guessing.
Yeah, and just... Yeah, it's the sheer scope of this game is unlike anything I've played. Like, I'm not a huge Zelda guy.
Yeah.
You know, the last thing I've played, I think, in the Zelda universe is Ocarina of Time way back when. You know, I dabbled on Wind Waker for about 10 minutes, and that's about it between. So I'm not of the ilk that Zelda's the greatest franchise known to man. So it's a bit more fresh-eyed for me coming into this, and especially where going from Horizon, I guess, where there was a little bit more hand-holding. You know, you've got a map going point A to point B, do this quest... level up here, pick how you want to play there, and you get none of that in here. It's just such an opposite experience to what I've been used to and what I've been loving for the past, you know, 2 weeks. Yeah. But I'm enjoying the challenge.
There's a genuine sense of awe coming from you right now.
Yeah,
I feel that too.
You're like, when you talk about Horizon, you're like really close to the microphone, your eyes are lit up, you're like a kid on Christmas Day. But now you're sitting and you're pondering this like a man reflecting on the good years of his life.
Just like he's just working out God. Like,
yeah, like you're really working
out. Like you've seen the face of God.
The miracle that is life.
Yeah, like
you're really kind of breaking it down for what it is.
Like, I can't wait until one of you guys gets a chance to experience this game because...
Yeah.
Now he's talking it's like something. A true religious fanatic.
Praise thee, Link.
Touching on Horizon Zero Dawn, one thing I did do this week that I forgot to mention. Man, I killed Redmaw.
Oh, that's a battle.
The freaking Thunderjaw. Yeah,
that is a battle.
Oh, it sucked.
That thing wrecked me. I think I died maybe 10 to 12 times trying to kill him.
It's this big Tyrannosaurus Rex. Like, they have these, like... These are like war Tyrannosaurus Rexes. Like, these things have big, like, rocket launcher things on either shoulder. Yeah. And
it goes from, like, a standard, say, a mechanical dinosaur, like, not much bigger than a human, to, like, a megazoid or something like that.
Sure,
like,
yeah. It dwarfs you, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the T-Rex of the game, aside from that big bird. I hate that bird as well.
Oh, yeah.
That bird's a... I don't want to drop the C-bomb here, but I'll be close. But, Thundermaw. Yeah, pain in the ass, because usually when I take down Redmaw, when I take down the Thundermaws, you just get the things off their shoulders, the missile launches, and then you just fire them back at them, and it's like half-held instantly, but you only get one off this guy. Yeah. There's nowhere to hide.
No.
Nowhere to hide to, like, cheese it.
Yeah, and your hawk companion just always gets knocked out.
Yeah, oh, your companion sucks.
She'll shoot 5 or 6 arrows, and then she gets one shot, and then she's out for like 2 minutes. So then you're the sole focus of this thing.
It's a stupid, it's a stupid fight, I think. It doesn't make a lot of sense that your arrows, like, I had to fling like 10 arrows to get it on fire, and then it's burning, but it's only doing like a tiny bit of damage.
I've got to hide
over like this stupid, like, inch of, you know, step where I can sort of get away from its late anyway. Stupid fight.
Not
the greatest thing in Horizon Zero.
Ended up using the frost sort of almost slingshot and just sort of frost, hit it with 4 of them, becomes frozen, obviously, and then you do like triple damage.
Right?
Yeah. And then you get
I didn't have one of those.
The bow and arrow that shoots the, like, it's almost like a pulse arrow and it actually shreds the armor off it. You just do that and then just... But yeah, that
I
fight
did something
was
similar
fucked.
In the end. It's not great.
Such a good battle. Yeah.
I hated it. I don't think it's a good battle at all.
Oh, it's just, it's hard as shit.
Yeah, but just give me something to hide behind.
Yeah.
I'm just
a metaphor for life, Sam.
I'm always looking for things to hide behind you. Always getting shit flung at me.
Sometimes when the T-Rex comes at you, just got to face it head on.
Nah, duck and run. It's my motto. Cool. Zelda, Horizon Zero Dawn.
Life. Obviously, we should probably touch base. We had a bit of a dabble last week. We played a bit of Bomberman on the Switch.
We did, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That is some crazy, crazy fun.
That will end friendships, that game.
Oh, yeah.
That is like the Switch version of Uno.
Yeah, especially when you're
Trump
all
is now
using
one.
The same character skin and then you can't work out who the hell is who.
Yeah, yeah.
My lordy.
We shouldn't have screwed up as many times as we did at the start. I think
it's
fun.
It's a bit of a learning curve, yeah.
When you die, you're then lobbing the bombs at like other people, and if your bomb
you're still
in
the game.
Back in. Yeah, you're still in the game. And that makes it even more fun.
Yeah.
And we were definitely going after each other.
It was getting intense.
Yeah. I really think that dying straight away can be a tactic, because you just put a bomb next to you, die, go around the veranda, if you will, and throw bombs at your teammates while they're all trying to get somewhere.
Yeah.
I've never thought of that. That is probably
a solid tactic. Yeah.
But it was fun. I haven't played it since that.
Yeah.
And maybe there is a bit more of a fleshed out single player mode. I doubt it. I could be very wrong, but I don't think this game's worth $60.
I don't know. Bomberman 64 had a very solid single player mode, and it was sick.
I used to play Bomberman like crazy on Game Boy. I love that game. Brought back a lot of memories, but
we did play Snip Clips as well.
Yes.
Which, you want to talk about ending friendships, we're all very close to calling.
Because you probably
THG quit right there.
Cutting them up and stuff.
No, it's not that.
You did it a few times.
Oh, I absolutely did it a million times. Mm. But that's not the thing that gets you. It is whenever there's a problem presented in front of three people, and three people have different ideas about how to solve the problem. It tests people's patience.
That's why me and my wife can never play this game, because I will not be able to suggest anything.
It was made harder. Like, one quick rule of thumb for anyone that does want to pick up Snipper Clips is it's either aimed to be played in two or four players. We played with three, and that still makes a fourth character in the game be controllable, so one person has to juggle between two characters.
Yeah, you're switching.
So just quick rule of thumb there. Make sure you've got an even amount of players, because it's freaking hard doing the work of two characters.
Yeah, we did sort of screw ourselves over on this one puzzle where we forgot that you can cut to the owls. There was one puzzle
the owl,
really,
and we had to bounce the egg across into the basket.
We're doing it on hard mode. Yeah.
Damn.
That was going to kill us.
But Snipper Clip still is one of the most fun games I've played in a long, long time. Yeah. Especially with friends that could then be enemies playing this game. $30 off the Nintendo store.
Or enemies that could become friends.
Yeah, $30. Well, any Switch owners, you need Snipper Clips.
Yes.
$30. It's the best investment.
Well, there's not a lot of content out there, so no doubt they've already come across it. We're just saying, get it.
Yeah, well, they've released a few more games this week. A few more of the little Neo Geo ports on there. So I think there's on the Australian store now, I think there's 20 games available now for the Switch. So it's not a bad launch collection, really. And it's going to progressively get updated over the next month or so. Like, in the next month, there's a ton more. There'll be a few more in the releases later. And then, obviously, at the end of April, we've got Mario Kart 8 Deluxe.
Sick.
Which is going to be great fun.
Which played well when we tried it at RTX.
Mm. Mm. Yeah. So it's been a good week. We've been playing some stuff.
Playing some stuff.
Yeah, so shall we talk some news headlines?
Yes.
This week's news headlines.
So the first one, I guess directly relating to what we just talked about, is that the Nintendo Switch is the fastest selling console ever, not only here in Australia, but also across the Americas, as well as Europe.
This surprises me a lot.
Yeah?
I thought the 360 would have been the biggest, or the PS4, more on PS3.
No, Nintendo's fastest selling. So,
fastest selling.
Yeah, it would still be. That's correct, right? It's not the fastest selling console. It's Nintendo's fastest selling console. Like,
that makes sense.
What are we comparing it against then? Wii U, Wii.
Just the Wii, or even the Nintendo DS.
3DS, DS. Well, each generation of DS would be its own version of console, wouldn't it? Like, you wouldn't count them all together, because I'm sure they'd just dwarf everything.
The DS had a pretty steady evolution, though. When it first came out, everybody panned it.
Really?
I think...
OG DS, yeah.
I think one of the biggest things as well is that Zelda Breath of the Wild outsold Wii Sports, which was a throw-in for the Wii. So not only the Switch outsold the Wii in the first week, but a game also outsold
the
Wii.
An external game, yeah.
Interesting. So what are the numbers?
What people want.
Do we have numbers, Brendan?
Some of the metrics over in France.
You're a numbers guy.
The Switch has sold 105,000 units. Over in Japan, I think it was 88,000 units over the first 2 days. In the US, I think it was about 150,000. So they're moving some numbers. Obviously, it's going to be interesting to see how it is 12 months down the line, 18 months down the line, if they're still supporting it, if it's still got a good attach rate. Because I think that was the thing with the Wii. Obviously, they've sold 100 plus million units on the Wii. But the early adopters, I think it was a bit slow to take off. But then a few months in, it just went...
The Wii, yeah.
Yeah. You know, and then it sold like hotcakes because it was a gaming system for more casual gamers that wanted a little bit more further interaction and a bit more fun as opposed to PlayStation or Xbox.
Was it released shortly before the PS3 and the Xbox 360 as well? It was It was very close to those two console launches.
It came out first and then the PlayStation and the Xbox.
Interesting. Well, in spite of the crazy price point that the Switch has come out at,
it's still far too high. Still far too high, but
well, the people have spoken with their wallets.
Yeah, like, and
they say switch it up.
Like, there's a lot of hate out there. Like, a lot of people are panning the dock. You know how we touched on it last week when there were like people on the streets. You know, the voice of the people. How they're saying that the dock is scratching the Wii U. I mean, not the Wii U, the Switch.
Really?
I did some further digging on it, and the only marks that you might get are on the bottom where it actually attaches to the dock. It's not like it scratches the screen because there's 10 mil either side of the screen. So unless you're a bit stupid and you're sort of rubbing it in and down the face, which is a human error, it's not a hardware error.
Getting something caught in there, like grains or crumbs.
You didn't like let me touch your Wii the other day, your Switch, sorry. Presumably because of my grubby hands.
Yes.
Do they have hooks in there where it hooks into place or does it kind of slide in?
It slides in.
So there's nothing kind of like keeping it from moving like left to right.
Oh, well, it's in there. It's like magnetized on the bottom. It sort of clicks in. So it's not going to like pivot at like a 20 degree axis forwards and backwards. Not really.
If I held it upside down, it wouldn't tip out?
Oh, I'd say so. I'm not going to try it.
Guys, what are we talking about here?
Give it a try. But I want to see
20 degree axis.
I
want
to see if we can get Brendan to do it. You should give it a try.
I think a lot of the
video. I guarantee you more video.
Don't listen to it. Do not look at his face. Do not listen to him.
Yeah, I don't want to break it.
You don't have to break it. You know, look, I'll buy you. Shit
eating half grin.
No, you won't.
I totally won't buy you anyone.
But a lot of the
can someone tip their thing upside down and tell me if the magnet's strong enough?
That's like when you put the phone in the microwave to see if it charges better or something. It's like, don't do that.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of the fire that's getting thrown on the Switch too, is just short-sighted stuff. Like, I know, funnily enough, we got caught out on it too when you slide the little bumper tops onto the Joy-Cons.
Oh, yeah.
You've got to marry up the pluses or the minuses. Yeah. So it's going to left-right. So you go plus to plus or minus to minus. And obviously, if we read the manual, we would have seen that. But we just went, whatever, we can put this together. And we put it on backwards. And a lot of people out there are like, oh, we've fucked this Joy-Con because we put this on the wrong way. And
it was solid. Like, it was firmly on.
Yeah, it's hard to get off.
I was terrified because we joked all day, like last Saturday, that I was going to break your Switch. And then I actually did that. I was very, very scared.
Yeah, so maybe that's a bit of a fault on Nintendo's side on that regard. Maybe it should be more universal. But at the same time, I looked and it is in the manual saying this is how you do it. So if we took the time to read that beforehand, you know, human
errors. I feel like they could have been a little bit more, I don't know, it could have been designed a little bit better. Because that's a pretty, it felt correct. Like when I slipped that thing on, I felt like there's only one way to do this, slide it in, it's fine.
Yeah.
Mm. Why does it need to be reversible?
Yeah. The dock is a bit flimsy and cheap. Like I did sort of take it apart a little bit just to see what's in the back end of it, and there's nothing.
It's what like, is? Yeah, sorry, just to explain it maybe to people who haven't seen it. It's when you get the Switch controllers and you split them up into the smaller controller.
Into the Joy-Cons,
Into the Joy-Cons. There's a slide-on attachment that we're talking about here.
And it just gives you bumpers on the top,
So we fucked that up.
Yeah. But like the Switch dock itself, it's just like this black plastic. The Switch clicks into it.
Yeah.
And then there's sort of like a little cable management on the back for your power and your HDMI. But it's just this cheap little PCB in the back. Like it's nothing special. Like, obviously they're there to make money, so obviously cheaper manufacturing the better. But that part there, once I popped it apart and had a look at it, I'm like, this is kind of a bit cheap. Like the Switch as a whole doesn't feel cheap, like the system.
Yeah.
Feels great, looks good, the colors and the graphics, they're vibrant, they're clean. The Joy-Cons feel okay. A little bit cheap feeling, I guess, because they're so small in your hand.
Mm.
But the Pro Controller, I've been playing a lot this week on the Pro Controller, where I'll have the Switch out of the dock, using little kickstand, just sitting on a table or whatever else, and just playing off the Pro Controller, and that feels great.
Yeah?
Feels so good. The Pro Controller, $100 is still way too much for it, but it actually feels sturdy. The buttons are nice and tactile. It's a solid controller.
Have you played it in any cool zany places yet, like a basketball court or an aeroplane?
I played it in my car.
Hey,
while driving.
In the back, like
no, I was
attached to the back of like the neck.
Down in Canberra the other week, I was in between meetings, and I got to this next meeting super early because there's no traffic in Canberra. Like, you get held up for 35 seconds in peak hour sort of thing.
They call that the public service Grand Prix, 15 minutes of hell.
Do they really?
Yeah.
Well, there you go. Okay.
Well, the peak hour in Canberra.
Yeah.
So I avoided the
Parliament House.
Yeah.
I avoided the public service Grand Prix, got to this meeting and I had like half hour to kill. Had my Switch in my work bag, took it out and I sat the Switch up on the front dash of the car, little kickstand out. Got my Pro Controller out and I was just sitting in the driver's seat playing a bit of Zelda as I waited for half an hour. That was pretty cool. Just playing it anywhere. Packed it away.
you get really excited talking about it.
He's the mobile nerd.
But yeah, then I packed it away and went and did my work or whatever else. But
you were thinking about Zelda the entire time.
I was. But apart from that, the only other place, I did play Zelda on the toilet just to say I can, and I did. That's the only
just
other time.
To say that you can.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Of course
God.
You can.
I know.
I could play Zelda on the toilet with a 64. Just because I can.
Oh, yeah, see that?
No cables.
Okay, you know what?
The one you're laying.
You know how people do challenges where they're like, I'm going to play Dark Souls with the Donkey Kong controller, or I'm going to, you know, do this game with the dance mat. You should do Ocarina of Time start to finish only when you're shitting.
No, that would be like one.
That's a lot of gameplay.
That's a
lot of toilet
I know.
Time.
That's a lot
I know.
Of toilet time.
That's like,
technically you can complete that game if you speedrun it and you know what you're doing. You can complete it in 18 minutes, I think the record
that's
was.
That's half an hour
ridiculous.
Or something. It's crazy. You should see the speedrunners doing it.
People are already starting to speedrun Zelda. Yeah. Breath of the Wild. Like, I haven't looked into any of it, but I saw it circulating on Twitch the other
Could
day.
Could not
like,
be as
God.
Broken as Ocarina. Like, the shit that people do in Ocarina, it's like, how did you work that out?
Mm.
They're backflipping backwards the whole time because it's faster. They know, like, how to angle into walls at certain times. They know that, like, if I go through this door after, like, doing XYZ over here, it'll take me to this room instead of this room. Fucking brilliant. Brilliant people. Anyway, that was a good little news bit.
That was. So, the Switch, it's...
Switches.
It's got some good attach rates so far. Like, people are keen, people are early adopters. Overall, the response out there has been pretty positive. I think the biggest bugbear is that the launch lineup was a little bit undercooked, but they've sort of come out and said, hey, we've got all these other titles this year, all these indie titles. We've got Mario, we've got Mario Kart, we've got this, that, the other. Like, it's good to see. It's
nice.
Good to see. And I don't regret it. I still, you know, 10 days in or whatever since I picked it up, I haven't got any regrets of buying this thing.
That's good.
Hmm.
We're not at that stage yet.
I know, you're watching that like a hawk.
You're not going to have, let's just put that out. You're not going to have regrets, but
oh, like,
I think it could be
there's
a
no
shelved.
Buyer's remorse.
Yeah, sometimes I go, fuck, I wasted money on that.
Yeah, I haven't seen you do that much, though.
I know I wasted money on that Hyperdeck. I've used that once and I haven't seen it in about 6 months.
Well, that's because you gave it to Dusty. Like, that's your fault.
Oh, wait, is that where it is right
yeah,
now?
It's still
you
Dusty.
May
oh,
have used
gonna,
it a little bit more if you had
claim
it.
That.
Maybe.
Yeah. No, I'm claiming that.
Oh, of course you are.
Oh, by the way, they're only like $400 ship now.
Yeah.
They've gone down again in price. Shout out to our friends at Digital Hype. Go and check them out on Facebook.
Check them out. Something else was announced this week. Gran Turismo Sport have come out and said there's going to be a closed beta for US-based PSN accounts from March the 17th. My thought process is, who the fuck cares? No one cares about Gran Turismo anymore.
No. It does have its own cult following, especially in Japanese circles. It's considered the game of games for racing.
I really don't think it is.
That is. I don't doubt any of that for a second. Like,
I doubt all of that.
The factual basis of that, what he just said, I don't doubt it at all. What mystifies me is how he knows it.
Mm.
That's what because
he's in that circle.
Me.
I am in that circle.
Yes,
DK.
I'm the very outer ring of that circle.
You but pulled that out of your ring. That's as close as it gets to the facts here.
Correct me if I'm wrong. It's just I.
Well, yeah, how do you, I don't know.
You can't.
For its day, yeah. When it came out, when it came out on PlayStation.
Safely on, no one can prove me wrong.
Yeah.
Safely on that side.
It should be a poly.
Yeah, when it came out in its day, it was known as, you know, I quote, the real life driving simulator, right? And it was a top tier driving game, but it's been left behind. Like, Forza has left this thing in its dust. And things like Drive Club's even more true to life and more realistic. That game that came out last year called Assetto Corsa, which is probably the most realistic car driving game that I've personally played.
But I have a theory that Gran Turismo maybe was not... I think it was successful.
It was.
I can't back that up. I just... My feeling on the game through the history of gaming was that Gran Turismo was successful. It was true a simulation of driving as you could get at the time that it was prominent, like 1, 2, and 3 I'm talking about. I think games like Need for Speed Underground were just so much more fun in the wake of like your Fast and Furious culture coming up that people just gravitated towards that shit.
Well,
for
yeah,
the next 5 to 10 years.
Need for Speed Underground.
Gran Turismo got left behind.
Need for Speed Underground popularity peaked as Fast and Furious movie came out. So
yes.
That all came out at the right time.
That's me, what I think happened.
As a diehard Gran Turismo player, it became like an absolute just addiction. To mod the cars, not even race the cars, just mod the cars so they were faster and could handle better. And I just got absolutely obsessed with it, you know, to the point where I was like, oh, I'll do this endurance race for 45 minutes to win a muffler. Like, that was my level of thinking with it. So I just think it's different. It's a different way of...
I think, yeah, it is.
It's been left behind.
You know what
franchise.
I didn't like about Gran Turismo is that you could go through the game and do your hardest to build the best car or whatever. But if you did a certain endurance race, you just got an F1 car and that was the best car in the game and nothing could ever beat it. So it was like game over.
Yeah.
So
Those were the days.
My biggest annoyance with Gran Turismo was the fact that there was no damage on the vehicles for so many of these franchises. Like, you just pinball off a barricade.
That's the same as, I mean, Need for Speed.
Oh, I like that.
At best, yeah.
No, but you crunch up your cars and you scratch them and windshields get broken.
Oh,
and you can't call the game a real life driving simulator when it bounces off things like a dodgy car.
Yeah, but this is like...
And I know a lot of it...
2002.
No, but a lot of... No, even in the later iterations, it was the same. There's no damage.
Gran Turismo.
Yeah. And I know a lot of this stems from the car licenses. Obviously, you know, when you sign up Ferrari to use their F50s and whatever else, obviously Ferrari don't want to show their cars smashed to bits. So probably they'll turn around and say no. Well, they want to show this thing in the best light, you know, with the sun glistening off the hood and all this shit.
I'm gonna stand with Reese on this. Only because I feel like he knows. You know what I mean?
Yeah, because he's in the GT
I'm
circuit.
I'm in the circles, mate. I'm in the circles.
Out of rim, but he's still on the rim. Mm. I'm far outside of it. Mm. Driving games are not my thing.
No, Gran Turismo is just a franchise that needs to evolve because it's dying.
Well, how do you evolve? You just become Forza.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Like, they're
just
like,
get a better soundtrack. That's
The soundtrack to Gran Turismo is always good. But
I think
the
more intricate modding of the cars is the best way to go.
Yeah, but this... Like, Gran Turismo Sport's been pushed back. This was meant to be out, I think, this time last year. And now they're doing a beta 12 months later that's
US
closed off.
Let's talk about that for a sec. If you're not in the United States, you can still get a PSN
Yeah, you just need to grab yourself a US-based address. Just Google anything.
Just get the same one you had for...
Paragon.
Paragon.
I have a Beverly Hills-based address because I'm apparently a baller on my US PSN account.
Baller in Australia, baller in his fantasy place in the United States
So it can be done. It's easy. The only thing then is tying a PayPal or a credit card to make purchases is a bit funky. So you might just have to buy... either your PSN time cards or your PSN, you know, $20 or $50 purchase cards. Buy them digitally and then just input the code.
Here's one for you. Books. Do you read them?
Yes.
So apparently, if you have a Kindle and a US-based Amazon account,
you do not read books.
I do.
Hold on. We'll ask him about the books. We'll make him prove it in a sec. But if you have a US-based Amazon account, you can get books so much cheaper than what you buy them for here.
Oh yeah,
if you get them on the Kindle,
yeah,
digital download saves you from having to do the dodgy, which you can't do in Australia anymore apparently.
I feel like it's too much effort. I can't be bothered
doing the... But you would... I figured you'd be like Saint US Amazon, because... or Saint Saving, at least, because you save like tens of dollars per book. Which is a lot.
Tens of dollars. That's
good.
Yeah,
but like that's... I don't know.
I know what you mean.
Prices may vary, but like you're saving a substantial amount of money. You're saving like, I don't know, 20, 30, 40%.
Yeah.
Which if you read a lot, like that's totally worth
it. Okay, but I'm like, if I want a book, I don't want to order it online. I just want to like...
You want a paperback?
Yeah.
I'm the same. Like I've got paperback. I like the thought and the convenience of having a Kindle or an equivalent ebook reader, whatever.
Yeah.
And having a library of them at your fingertips 24/7.
There's a certain arrogance that comes with having a paperback book these days.
I love it.
But like when I read on like say the train, part of me is conscious of the fact that I'm reading on a train.
Yeah, because you want to look hot in front of girls.
Yeah, that's it.
Educated with your khaki shirt. It's great. It's a great look.
Khaki, double-breasted.
There needs to be...
You could put Kindles in either of those pockets.
Could probably...
Just rocking double Kindles. Just make a vest out of Kindles.
This is fiction, this is non-fiction.
I was thinking about tattoo ideas today because of the tattoo expo.
Two Kindles?
And I thought, what if I just got two hands tattooed over my...
like Janet Jackson
pecs.
My pecs, yeah. Is that weird?
Yes, because that would be like Janet Jackson.
What is the reasoning behind this?
Just, I don't know, I want to get a weird tattoo.
That's pretty weird.
You've already got...
I think you've...
some weird tattoos.
You've picked the winner.
Not weird, just regretful. Two regretful tattoos.
Just get a bunny rabbit spreading its butt cheeks over your belly button. That's a good one.
Gosh.
Okay, maybe.
It's a good one.
It's not a no. What else you got for us, Brendy?
Yeah. Right.
It's just the land of the beta, apparently. So registrations are currently open for Quake Champions.
Oh, okay.
Head on over to quake.bethesda.net and you can register for the beta, which is apparently going to be starting in the next 2 to 3 weeks.
Wonder if we'll
PC
see the same
only
hype.
For now. Keep that in mind, console players.
Mm.
But I've registered. I obviously don't know if I'll get in or not. They didn't sort of say if it's going to be open, amount of players they want to try and get in this first batch.
Mm.
Hopefully one of us can get in and we can play it and give some early feedback.
Mm.
It's playable all this weekend at PAX, from what I'm aware of, at PAX East over there at the moment. So we'll probably see some hands-on opinions trickle out over this weekend.
Great.
Quake's cool.
Yeah.
I like playing Quake. In Melbourne, at the ACMI, they have PC set up with a LAN set up with the old-school Quake.
Really?
Yeah. Very cool. Very fun. Totally free as well, if you're a bit of a cheapskate.
That's me.
Or just broke. That's me. Yeah, so that's cool. I don't know that Quake will take anything away from Overwatch. Team Fortress 2... TF2, that's the one we're waiting on, right? Or new Team Fortress.
Well, they've already got Team Fortress.
Yeah, TF2's already out.
Yeah, not TF2. The one they announced last year at
E3.
I don't know. That's not Quake
Champions, announced Quake Champions.
Oh, is it Quake Champions?
Yeah.
Fuck, I'm way off. Yeah. All right, well, this is the one that looked a lot like Overwatch.
Yeah, and Unreal Tournament.
An Unreal Tournament.
Yeah, so any Quake fans out there or FPS fans?
Like all the characters have special moves now.
Yeah, ultimates or whatever they call them.
Yeah, they're not just kind of skins.
Mm. A couple of other announcements that dropped this week. So Outlast 2, the first-person survival horror made by Red Barrel Games, is going to be releasing on April 25th on PC, PlayStation 4, and Xbox One. That was our first ever combined Let's Play, doing that Outlast 2 demo.
Oh, true.
Available on youtube.com/we are 8bit. Yeah, watch us get scurred.
That was a thing.
That was a thing.
That was a real thing.
Yeah, so what, maybe when the game comes out, maybe we'll dip our toe again.
Nah.
The salmon horror doesn't work very well, does it?
It doesn't work at all, man. Doesn't go well with my anxiety. Especially in VR.
Yeah. That video.
You really dialed it up as well for the Outlast thing. Like, you drew the curtains or you put them down and you made sure it was, like, super dark.
Yeah.
Mad headphones from Audio Technica. Shout out to Audio Technica.
Shout out.
Yeah, you really dialed it up for us, so thank you.
So we need to get some more gameplay of us, or Let's Plays of us playing these types of games.
Yeah,
it's good fun.
Sure.
Good fun. Something else is good fun that I know Curbs is excited for.
Yeah.
Dawn of War 3, dropping April 27th on the PC.
Severely underrated game. If you haven't played Dawn of War stuff before, the first and the second one are definitely miles apart in terms of their style of gameplay. Personally, I prefer the second one. They've just gone down in price on the Steam website, so get on it. I believe the Master Collection is $10.
No, that's pretty good.
That's a great amount of money there that you can spend. Let's talk a little bit about Dawn of War 3.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about it.
I've seen a bit of gameplay on it. Obviously, I've been watching it very closely. I've signed up for the beta.
Mm-hmm.
I believe I will be a part of that beta. I'm
Me too,
excited, but also cautious. Haven't seen a lot of the Space Marine human race be demonstrated. A lot of it is the
the Eldar.
Eldar, yeah.
Yeah, it's been a big focus on them from what I've seen in all the trailers and stuff.
But I'm still going to play it. I love the style, and, you know, Relic games, for me, I think are severely underrated. If you've ever played Company of Heroes, Dawn of War 2 is a very similar experience to that. So, minimum requirements for Dawn of War 3, minimum 64-bit Windows 7, 3 gigahertz or i3 or equivalent, 4 gig of RAM and a 1 gig NVIDIA GeForce or DirectX 11 video card.
So it's pretty low bar.
Yeah. For a minimum.
Did you get those insider tips from one of those Gran Turismo meets?
No.
By chance?
No, I didn't.
Talking tech?
Why would I?
No, you're tuning cars. It's mechanical. They use computers to tune cars. Maybe you started talking about Dawn of War.
Really,
you're seeing connections
there,
where there aren't connections.
Really,
oh, there's connections.
Put down the pinball,
I'm
going to
call you Stretch Armstrong.
great band. Great toy.
the recommended
specs. Great. For once,
specs.
I'm not the instigator or the enabler.
Okay. Recommended specs. 64-bit Windows 10. 3 gigahertz i5 or equivalent. 8 gig of RAM. 2 gig NVIDIA GeForce card.
Was that recommended specs?
That's recommended. It's not amazing. You know, it's not, I love that. It's great. But all smiles over here.
Yes. Yeah, they're good games, man. And you've definitely been on the Dawn of War bandwagon for a number of years.
Yeah,
it's like probably the one game, outside of Gran Turismo, of course, that I associate with you, though, so clearly, is Dawn of War. Every internet cafe night we go out to, you'd obviously be up for it. But they are good games.
Getting on that Imperial Devastator is just amazing. The laser tank.
I played one, and I remember... What are the Necrons? Is it the Necrons?
Necros?
It's kind of like they have pyramids. Yeah. And they're metal dudes.
Terminators, yeah.
I remember playing them. You have to attach everything to your base.
Yeah, So that was the first one was base building. But they did away with that in the second one.
Really?
Hero based, where you level up the hero.
So it's
and
like an RTS, just point and click, run around.
Yeah, so there's still heroes in this game.
You've got to activate the different abilities of each hero, and it's squad based. So the thing I loved about it is that you had four different heroes in your team, and one of them was a sniper, one of them was a demolitions expert, one of them was a hand to hand, and one of them was a DPS. So it's like you would activate the different. One guy had a turret, one guy had a spider mine. It was like setting up the different traps for enemies and stuff. I loved it, man. I love that game.
See, you say all of that, and the one thing I just think is how much I love Warcraft 3's campaign mode.
Yeah.
Which is very similar.
Yeah.
It's like
I would agree with that, for sure.
Yeah.
I'm just waiting.
Door 3.
I just want them to announce Chaos, because that's what brought me back into Dawn of War when they did the Chaos expansion in Dawn of War 2.
Yeah.
They were always my boys, going back to the physical
miniatures.
Yeah. They haven't announced them yet at this stage for 3. Obviously, it's only Space Marines, Eldar, and the Orcs.
Well, they're notorious for doing expansions, yeah. So I imagine.
Sneaky, sneaky.
I would personally love to see the Tau Empire be introduced. Mm. The Tau Empire were the guys who were loosely based on the droid army from Star Wars. And are a little bit sort of mecha looking.
Roger, roger.
Yeah. So I would love to see those guys be introduced because I really always love the aesthetic.
Well, they're bringing in these big walker units as well, you see.
The like mega knobs.
The mega knobs.
Because they're the big guys on the orc side. Yeah, they're literally called the mega knobs. And I tweeted
the Gorkonauts is what they're calling their big sort of destroyer.
I tweeted
the Wraith Knights.
And I was like, I can't wait
to Imperial Knights.
Literally say, release the mega knobs.
Like, you say that most weekends, don't you?
Yeah, well, it's just every day, really.
Turn a couple of candles on, or light a couple of candles even.
Turn a couple of candles. This is 2017, mate.
There is electric candles.
The future.
Yeah.
What's a Zazie Beetz?
She is an actress.
What?
That's not Zazie Beetz.
Yeah, so on the next one.
Yes. Oh, so sorry. Don't let me take away from you.
Zazie Beetz.
Oh, go.
No, I didn't
give it a crack, Sam.
You butchered it already.
I didn't even see the second
keep
half.
Keep carving it up.
Line.
And over to our live cross to Sam Abraham with some news regarding Zazie Beetz.
So Zazie Beetz, famous for her roles in other movies she starred in, is
I think she's most
locked into
cracking stuff.
Sorry, go on. You wanna?
She's currently starring in Atlanta. She's one of the characters in Atlanta.
Gotcha.
So she's been cast as Domino for Deadpool 2.
Domino. Which one's Domino?
Domino is like this crew, like they put her through trials and she's like this perfect weapon. So she's like this super assassin, really. She partners up with Deadpool, you know, they do stuff in X-Force and a whole other few things as well.
Is she a goodie, a baddie, or a kind of goodie baddie?
Oh, well, they're all sort of anti-heroes, you know?
Mm. Yeah.
They're all that good when it suits them, generally sons of bitches, funny, sarcastic, violent, whatever. Like, but yeah, I don't know too much about Zazie Beetz. I still haven't watched a single episode of Atlanta.
So I feel like I have to. Everyone keeps saying you should.
Sam would like it. I don't think Brendan would like it.
There you go.
Okay.
What I am liking on the TV spectrum, the 5th episode of Legion just aired yesterday or Thursday. Fuck, that show's good.
What's that about?
It's about David Haller, who is, if you're going, they haven't directly joined the dots in the show yet, but he is the son of Professor X and another lady. He's like known as or seen as one of the most powerful mutants in the universe from the X-Men universe. But you know, they like growing up, he feels like he's got all kinds of mental illness because he's hearing voices and blah blah blah, but it's actually he's got multiple personalities in his mind with multiple powers. So he's just this super strong guy that can teleport, move items, go to different universes, the whole works. But it is so good. It's a more of a darker, more serious, grounded tone. You know, similar to, you know, what Deadpool and Logan are having success with now in this superhero realm, where they're touching, you know, a bit more raw subjects and it's a lot less kiddie and more serious tonally. Like, there's still some lighthearted moments in it, but it is so good. Watch it, seriously. I've been harping on this for 5 weeks now.
What?
Check it out.
Who owns, like, the X-Men property cinematic?
Fox.
Fox. And Fox did Deadpool.
Yes.
Okay, alright. So that explains why there's such a shift in tone.
Yeah.
Right?
Did we get a confirmation on Cable? Because I heard there was rumors.
They still haven't announced the casting yet.
I heard it was going to be
old mate from Stranger Things.
From Stranger Things, yeah. Hopper.
Yeah, he's done.
Who's in Australia. For some reason.
Him and 11 are here for Supernova or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Whatever it might be.
Nice.
Mad.
He did a reading, I think, last week. I could see him in the role, but I don't know if he's gruff enough.
I could see him as McCree in the Overwatch movie.
Yes. He'd be perfect as McCree.
I know, right.
Sort of plays that role in Stranger Things, doesn't he? Sheriff.
Yeah, true.
That's but, who he is.
Yeah, I like Cable. Ron Perlman would be a great Cable.
Ron Perlman's too old.
No, he's too old.
No, but Cable is old. And he's got silver hair and he's
Ron
old
Perlman's
and grizzled and gritty.
Too old.
No, he doesn't have the body. Man. I love Ron, but no.
He doesn't have the body. Yeah, you're right. He was a weird Hellboy.
But he's a big man.
He's amazing Hellboy.
He's like especially post Sons of Anarchy, he's like a burly man.
Yeah, but that's who
he's
Cable
got old
is.
Man gut. Bro, if I'm thinking Cable, I want to see not that I have a like a horse in the race on this thing, but what's his name? Dolph Lundgren. That's a cable, bro.
He's even older than Ron Perlman, I think.
He can still sling it together, man.
He's got the aesthetic for it, I agree. Give him some silver hair. I don't know if he has the acting chops.
Let him run.
I don't know if he has the acting chops.
Act. The other one that they keep throwing around is the old guy, the main antagonist from Avatar. He's the other guy that they're constantly parading. And he'd fit that because he's fucking
jacked. He looks like the main guy from that movie, Small Soldiers.
He does. That's voiced by Tommy Lee Jones.
Yeah.
The lead guy.
Yeah.
I love that film.
Tommy Lee Jones.
No.
For Cable.
No.
Who's the guy we were talking about the other week? We're talking about Suits.
Yes.
And there was that guy who was also in like a Killers film clip.
I don't remember talking about the Killers film clip.
Yeah, he's
in it. I can barely remember what happened this morning.
Eric Roberts.
Yeah, Eric Roberts. Eric Roberts for Cable kind of works.
Maybe.
Maybe not as big, but
Eric
you know.
Roberts for Cable.
Everyone can get on the roids these days and just pump up.
Yeah.
Just balloon a little bit. You can do it.
It'll be interesting when that comes out.
Very interesting. So 2018 is when Deadpool 2 drops, so they're going to have to cast someone soon.
Such a long wait.
Who would you want to see in it? I saw like fan art of Keira Knightley as Cable the other day.
No.
Nah, they also did her as Domino as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah. She would have worked as Domino, but some of the fan art... Boss Logic's already... You know, he's pumping out fan art left, right, and center.
He's so good.
Of sort of the comic geeky universe with actors. And he's already done one of Zazie Beetz, and it looks great.
Mm.
Check it out. I think it's just Boss Logic, all one word on Instas, Twitters, the like. Does some great stuff. Immortalized myself and Kirby forever too. So
there you go, yeah.
Thank you,
an
brother.
Original piece.
Oh, God, I was so close to pulling that out the other day.
My Wolverine one?
Yeah. Brendan got commissioned to work where it's him as Wolverine, and it is amazing. It's cool. It looks great.
I'd like to see
Sam. I
want to
share it.
Sam as Tracer.
With a little cute butt.
Yeah. His little butt sticking out.
I could do that.
The bastard's here.
Is that the cavalry?
Yeah.
Is that a play on the cavalry?
Yeah.
That's great.
Is that how you see me?
You're a lovable bastard.
Oh, man, you're breaking my heart.
That's all right.
Zazie Beetz.
Playing Domino in Deadpool 2 at 2018.
Mad.
The last bit of news for this week ties into Destiny 1 / Destiny 2. So Destiny 2 obviously has been confirmed to be released sometime in 2017.
Yep.
The various producers of the game have come out and confirmed that character experience will not carry over from Destiny 1 to Destiny 2. They are saying that aesthetics, so say character model, race, your markings, your face stylings, your hairstyle, all that, you can import that. So
people
you can still have the same look, the same armor shaders. So if you did do a lot of hard work in Destiny 1 and did all the raids, got all the high-end gear, you will be rewarded and acknowledged for that. There will be, on release of Destiny 2, certain shaders or certain avatar icons or whatever they call it. You know how you've got your banner over your name and your level point?
Your little flag thing.
Yeah, so there'll be some unique sort of acknowledgements and hat tips for the hard work that Destiny players did put into Destiny 1.
Mm.
There has been a bit of initial uproar, but I think it's dumb. Like, why would you want to start max leveling a whole new game anyway? Especially, it's a whole new universe, so it's new worlds, new enemies, all that stuff. So, start fresh, but
it's
if you can carry your look through, I like that idea that you
new
can...
New journey.
Yeah. Mm. You guys big Destiny players? I know we were hard out for a little while, Sam.
I don't mind it.
Mm.
I never got into it as much as everybody else did, but... there is a few people that I do know that are hardcore Destiny players that are very pissed off with this revelation that they're going to have to somewhat start again. But I see it the same way you do, is it's a new experience. And
I wonder how much of it's transferable as well anyway. Like, you have your classes in Destiny at the moment, and
none of that's transferable. Anything. From what I've heard, it's new classes.
Yeah, see,
new classes, new abilities.
Then how do you transfer any of it? And it's unfair to get an experience boost because you're, you know... graded Destiny 1. It doesn't work like that for any game. You don't even The Witcher, right? Even when you trade saves into The Witcher, like from 2 to 3.
Mm.
Sorry to keep going back to that well, but like
you start from base level on your experience.
Yeah,
I admire that the developers and whatnot there at Bungie are taking the time to at least say, let's still carry some of your hard work and your effort through, where you can still live the life of character X that you created and plug them into this new universe and still look the same way. Obviously, it'll play differently with new classes and abilities and whatnot.
Let's be real as well. It's not a fucking hard grind. Compared to many other games, Destiny's got to be one of the easiest grinds.
It's very accessible. I've ever had. Especially later in the piece.
Yeah.
Obviously, with the later expansions where when you bought... What was the... King?
Yeah.
I'm having a mental blank.
Fallen King, Forsaken King.
The Taken King.
Taken King. Yes.
When you buy the Taken King expansion and you had an item in your inventory where you could level, like start a new character and drop this item and you'd be straight away jumped to level 25.
Yeah.
So you can avoid all the bottom end crap and get straight into the raids and the more higher end stuff. So on the back of that announcement with the Destiny 2 carryover, they've also confirmed that in the last patch for Destiny 1, they're going to be leveling up all the previous raids. So House of Wolves, Vault of Glass, so on and so forth. They're going to pull all them up to level 400 for your light level. So then the old original version 1 raids, I guess you could call them, are worth going back and playing them, because it's going to be an adequate challenge for the max light level guys. You can get higher light level weapons and armor. So that's cool.
For a free-to-play game, it's done well. Like, they've serviced it very well over the last 2 years.
Mm. Yeah, they've created a good universe. Obviously, the story is paper thin.
There's been a lot of back and forth between the community and Bungie as well. A lot of crazy shit gone down between those two rival groups, those rival gangs. But yeah, it's come good.
Hmm.
Yeah. Just give us fucking Sparrow Racing and we'll be happy. All the time, not as a timed event.
I didn't even take part in the timed event. Like, I
don't give a
like,
shit.
Yeah, like, yeah. I guess it's a good disconnect from raiding and grinding
it's
and all
that
crap.
Though. When you jump on your Sparrow to like cross a map, it handles well. It handles nicely.
The true racers take part in Gran Turismo trials, though. That's the thing. We don't waste our time with Sparrows.
Be in those rims.
And Reese on the rebuttal?
No, you just got to be in the rims.
He agrees.
Got to grab him in the ring rims?
Yeah.
Well, that's it. Yeah, I suppose it's very easy for you on the outside, Brendan, to poke holes at it. Mm. But once you're inside, that's where it's
in Gran Turismo or in Sparrow Racing?
In the GT rims, bro. That's when it's real. You know,
I'm in the inner circles of Forza.
Forza.
That's where the real
Forza
racing comes from.
Inner circles, I don't think.
Forza.
I think you're reaching again.
I've never played Forza.
It's Stretch
good.
Armstrong.
It's fantastic.
It's fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know what else is good? Gran Turismo.
It was good.
Was good.
Past tense.
Well, you know. You know.
I do know. I also know that there's a slew of games coming out this week.
A slew.
A slew.
Tell me about your slew.
So we're talking about the calendar week that is March 13 through 20. So on March 14th, Danganronpa 1 and 2 Reload is on PS4.
Mm-hmm.
Star Trek Bridge Crew finally releases on a couple of other platforms on March 14 on the Rift
there?
And the Vive.
Any interest on that one?
I've thought of it. It's $80 though.
Mm.
I don't know if I'm going to get $80 worth of entertainment
so.
And experience out of it. Like,
yeah.
I'd like Star Trek. I like that universe. I'm more of a Star Wars guy. Obviously, they're the two sci-fi universes that have warring factions and whatnot.
You know, what's the Kobayashi, whatever it is, the training exercise they do in the first Star Trek reboot film?
Mm.
I think that's what this is.
Oh, okay. Maybe.
No, I mean, like, that's what I feel
envision
like
it would be.
Yeah, just
okay.
Like shit, basically. Boring. It looks boring. You just sit on the chair and... Because you wouldn't move, would you, Stuart?
No, you'd
some
be
people
just pretty stationary. You might move your hands
would
around
die
or...
To have that.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sure to go down big with the EVE Online crowd.
Oh. Yeah, and you know, being able to, like, sit there and be, like, going, engage, or, like,
yeah.
You know, take us home, Mr. Sulu, or whatever the hell, you know, whatever other catchphrase.
Shields to maximum.
Yeah.
Beam me up,
you know,
Scotty.
So, for the Star Trek, the Trekkies, not the Star Trekkies.
The Trekkies.
The Trekkies out there will probably love this. You know, they can wear their Star Wars
outfit.
Oh, fuck, not Star Wars. Sorry, Trekkies. Yeah, they're yellow or red skivvies and, you know, dropping gauges in their lounge room all day long. So,
nice.
What else is nice is Styx Shards of Darkness comes out on March the 14th on PS4, Xbox One, and the PC.
Mm.
Senran Kagura Peach Beach Splash on March the 16th on the PlayStation 4. And the last one, The Binding of Isaac Afterbirth Plus, drops on the Switch on March 17. So it was originally meant to be a launch title. Pushed it back 2 weeks. God knows why. But it's still out.
It's the game that just keeps on making money.
The 17. Yeah.
It's been quiet, but it's been there for like, what, 3 years?
Mm. It's just humming.
Mm.
Love to be those guys.
Mm. So no events this week. There's nothing doing. It's barren. Just play some games. Go watch Logan a few times.
Yeah.
Go watch Logan. Just on events. Last week, I didn't talk about this, but in Sydney we had the monthly YSB, York Street Battles, which is held by the guys at Ozido. It's like the fighting game tournament.
How'd you go?
I got there so fucking late that I wasn't... I was too late to compete. I was too late. Mm. But I got to have a bit of a play later in the evening. It was good fun watching the guys play Tekken and Street Fighter. The guys here are so good, man.
Better than you?
So much talent. People fly from all over Australia to come to this thing.
Whoa.
Like, they don't make it to every single one. They run at the last kind of Saturday of every month, thereabouts. But people certainly come from interstate just to, like, play there. And you see so many good dudes there, man.
Mm.
Good guys and gals there playing the best games in the world. Tekken 7 and then other fighting games.
Is there another event coming up soon?
Yeah, I think the 24th of March.
Okay.
I think.
Just check it out online. Ozido.
Yeah, I think it's ozido.net.au, I think, is their website. Right?
I think so. You can find it if you go Ozido on Google, if you go that.
Or if Firefox.
You go York Street Battles on Google.
Bing, maybe.
Nah, Bing. Bing.
Yeah, you could do Bing.
God, I would unfriend someone who actively uses Bing.
You have to use Bing in my office if you...
Really?
Do you just,
like a lot of people do because they don't have the...
You feel like you've got access. Something on your skin when you're using Bing. It's like, oh, it's not working.
Mm.
Yuck.
I don't think I've ever used it, so I can't... I've got no horse here.
I think it's like big now in companies because it's not tied into a mail server, so it's safer than, say, Gmail and Google, where you can hook your Gmail in and send secret documents to your personal account. Know what I mean?
I do.
On that internet cybersecurity train.
Yes. Yes. So we are going to open up the mailbag. It's been some time since we've dove into this because we seem to just rant more and more and more in our episodes.
Going deep in that bag.
Oh.
Sound effects.
That's fantastic.
That's right. Go fuck yourself.
Okay, so this letter reads, "Hello, hope life is treating you well. It was lovely to meet you all at RTX and I had a great time catching up. It was awesome. It was also really good to hear your voice against the wider media who simply don't get, in brackets, get games.
Wow.
And will trash on them at any chance they get. Whenever the major networks do a story about tech or pop culture conventions, they're always laughing and taking the piss. It's frustrating! Exclamation point. Anyway, here are some more questions for you. First question. What's an old thing that you've tried that still feels so fresh and new? I've been watching classic sci-fis like Alien and The Thing, and gave the first Metal Gear Solid a crack after Kojima's interview at RTX. These films and games still feel modern to me, and I'm curious to hear what stands out for you. The next question. Knowing what you know now, how would you go about starting a podcast? How much planning goes/should go into each episode? Any equipment recommendations, in brackets, entry level? Finally, how would you handle doing interviews with those who aren't as experienced with being recorded? That might be a lot of questions, but if you're cool with answering them, that would be awesome. Hope to hear back from you guys soon. Cheers, Dylan from Victoria, not Canada.
Dylan, you know we absolutely love you. I feel like you really stitched us up with that second question. How much prep do we put into episodes? Thank you, Dylan.
Let's go first
question. Let's tackle the first question. Yeah, so what's an old thing that you've tried but still feels fresh and new?
Sex.
Yes. Same. Okay.
Okay.
We're going to that well straight away.
Just to stay on topic, I watched the original Aliens last Saturday night.
Hang on. Alien or Aliens?
Well, Alien.
Okay.
The first one.
First one.
I've got a thing to ask after this. Sorry.
So, yeah, you know, I started watching those again to get into the mood of the new Alien coming out, just to refresh my memory. Still feels great. Warrior Land 4, as I mentioned a couple of weeks back, I've been playing that. That's a lot of fun. Mm. I booted up Metal Slug on iOS. Because I love Metal Slug. That's probably one of my favorite arcade games.
Side note, Metal Slug was one of the Neo Geo releases on the Switch this week.
Nice, because that's a really
$9
good
bucks,
game.
I think it is.
Some of the best art, I think, in games, personally. Mm.
I love rescuing the POW hippies with their long hair and beards. Anyway.
There's that. I'm always looking for something old to refresh and revive, because it's not often that new stuff really kicks over every single week for me. Sometimes it'll be a barren couple of weeks with nothing coming out. So
I think with the amount of effort we put into staying informed on like things, new games, events, blah blah, it gets a bit taxing to maybe just go after the new release, because you're just so enthralled in it anyway, or enthralled by it, you know, reading into it, interviews, reviews, blah blah. You've played the game before you've played it. Yeah. When you play something old, it's like finding a hidden gem.
It's your own experience. It's kind of
nice. Yeah, I think film and television stands up more as opposed to the majority of games.
Yeah, I agree with that, definitely.
Like film and television and music and that type of media, it's timeless, really. Mm. You know, obviously effects and things can be a lot eroded compared to today. You know, it's noticeable with whether it be physical and like literal animation or software based like CGI and things like that. But stemming from what you and Dylan said, like Alien, The Thing, the Terminator franchise, Predator franchise. I grew up like as a kid as just a massive sort of sci-fi action buff, and I can still go back and watch all these movies with a great amount of love and admiration for what they did. The story still holds up, the acting holds up, the pacing, everything like that. But there's probably not a whole lot of games that I'll go back and play from yesteryear and still push through them. Like on one end, I'll go back and every year I watch, you know, say the Lord of the Rings trilogy. I try and do like a back-to-back-to-back every year, and every year I try and watch the Terminator films and the Predator films, all these films from when I was a kid.
Yeah.
Or when I was younger, but there's not many times where I'll go back and play old games that I've held dear. Like, it's sort of polar opposites. Like, I'm always trying to play the new stuff and sink my teeth into new titles and IP and product, where media is probably something where I go back to that older, more nostalgic well.
I dusted off my PS2 last week. Played a bit of Rise to Honor. That's a great game.
Still working?
Yeah.
Well, that's pretty impressive.
Yeah.
Via the RCA?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, Rise to Honor is a sick game.
Yeah, like the only franchise that I've played that's old, and it's still only 10 years old, like I played through the Mass Effect games again over the last 6 or so months in anticipation of Mass Effect Andromeda, but for the most part, there's not a huge amount of titles where I'll go back and play some of these old classics. Like, I can look back and remember fond memories of some of these old games, but not to a degree where I go, you know what, I'm going to go back and play title X or title Y or title B or whatever. Like,
yeah, nostalgia's the key here, obviously. I think the only ones I can really do are the Final Fantasy games from maybe 1 to 10. Those are the only ones that I could maybe jump into and it'd still feel great and fresh, and it's probably because they're so similar between them but also very different. They tweak it obviously with each iteration, so that helps. But yeah, there's not much else I can play that I've I mean, I've, like, things like Pokemon Red. I've played Pokemon Red. I've probably done more than 100 solid runs of Pokemon Red.
Jesus, that's impressive.
Least. Like, that's as huge. A kid, and then kind of later on, and then there's ROMs, and then you Nuzlocke. And it's hard to play that game anymore as much as I loved it and as much time as I put into it. Mm. I still get a sense of enjoyment playing Tekken that is fresh, and I think that's just more the competitiveness of it, rather than the game doing something new or inventive. It's just more about challenging
the community
and playing with other people. Yeah, and I think a lot of people who play any competitive game would have that. Like Warcraft, you know, I could play a game of Warcraft 3 tomorrow with someone else and that would still feel new and fresh to me. But yeah, you're right. Outside of that, there's not really much else. TV-wise, movie-wise, there's a lot. You know, like you, I try and watch certain things at least once a year just because, you know, they're brilliant. The Sopranos is a great show. Should be watched once a year. I think The Wire is fantastic. Should be watched once a year if you can get around to it. Yeah, that's it, I guess, for me.
The podcast question, just hit up Audio Technica for all your needs.
All your needs.
They've got everything you need. Look, there's plenty of great YouTube videos and tutorials and stuff out there. Like,
how would you go about starting a podcast? How much planning goes into it? Equipment recommendations.
First of all, you got to.
So, yeah, okay.
I think
you need an idea.
Yeah, like
which separates you from the. I mean, we're on AGPN. There's so many podcasts out there. I think you need an idea and a format that sets you apart from everything else. That, like, what have you got to advertise to people to give them a reason to listen to your podcast? Number two, do you have a personality that is quite forthcoming and is something... Have you done any kind of presenting before? Have you been on stage? Are you a performer? Have you done that? If you haven't done that, it might be difficult for you to get that personality out there.
Yeah, we've got a friend at the moment who's doing a podcast. It's not a gaming podcast. It's just sort of a variety show, I think they're calling it. They're doing a few different things with it. And I had a chat with him. This is Macha, who
friend of the show.
Friend of the show, and when we can get him, helps us out with things. But he, very rarely, but still has given us a hit in the past once or twice. But Macha, I was talking to him about it. He'd just done his first two episodes with his two housemates. And he's giving me all of his grievances, and there's like a lot of things that he's saying there that I, you know, reflecting on it, thought we shared that experience. So when we started, we didn't quite know what this would be. I think we all had ideas, and then it changed into something that was a little bit different to probably what we were all expecting, but still something pretty good, something great, and something that we loved enough to do for 15 months. I don't know, and we're still going to keep going. We're not going to kill each other yet. So I think you just need to be patient, and you just need to be a bit brave about it. And throw yourself out there. Like you said, Reese, you know, you may not be someone who has done something where you're speaking in front of people or giving an opinion or voicing an opinion. And it's not easy. And it's not easy to listen back to yourself either the first few times.
yeah, it really isn't, like...
Yeah, I think just be patient with it and just fucking go for it. I think anything creative, any creative pursuit...
As soon as you put pen to paper, you've done 1,000% more.
Yeah, like
the 10 minutes leading up.
Put your ideas down. Like, have a direction of how you want this show or this potential product or concept to go. Talk with, like, if you're going to be, it's a solo podcast or a group podcast. Think of people that would work, or you've got dynamic, or some good back and forth with. And see what your strengths are. Like, be honest with yourself. Go, okay, I might not be the most informed about this, but I'm really good with that. So maybe shift focus to that specific area. Like, you're never going to be the master of anything. Like, I'll admit, you know, I know bits and pieces here or there, but there's a lot of things I got no idea about. So I'll try and read about that or study up on that or focus on your strong points. Just, as Ree said, just put something out there. That's the biggest step. You know, record an episode... Record one or two episodes before you put it up and listen back and deconstruct that episode. How did it go? What didn't you like? What would you change?
Have a theme, have music, have something like to make it semi-professional. Don't just start by saying, well, here we are. Like,
I don't know about that. To be fair, I agree. And I like, you know, where things are polished, but there are plenty of podcasts that don't do that and still quality shows.
Yeah, but the good thing,
it's content, I think. It's whatever the core of it is, hopefully it's something that you love doing, not just something that you think you need to do.
And the good thing is there's a lot of communities out there that are more than happy to engage and have discussions and provide advice. You know, us here directly, hit us up, you know, shoot us an email, shoot us a message. More than happy to share our wins and losses and sort of pain points. As Reese said, the AGPN Facebook page, there's copious amounts of podcasts on there. Jump in there, ask some questions,
and plenty of people that are willing to help.
Yeah,
as well as the other,
and the other one that I sort of dig around in here and there is there's a subreddit, and it's just slash podcasts or slash gaming podcasts or whatever field you want to focus in. Get in there, ask questions. People are more than happy to share their knowledge and their advice.
And always buy Audio Technica.
Yeah. Make sure, like, if you like, that's the easiest thing that you can have direct control over straight away is the equipment. If you buy the equipment, that'll see you through from now until forever. Obviously, the content would vary week to week or episode to episode, but if the gear sounds all right, even if you're not completely confident to start with, if the gear can sort of mask some of those inadequacies, you know, the last thing you want to do is have five people sitting around a room sharing one mic and there's inconsistent tone and pitch thrown around and background noise and da-da-da-da-da.
Yeah. I think on a technical level, that's a bit of a, like, I'm out. If I hear, like, a podcast, then it's not great.
Yeah.
Sound-wise, I don't know about you guys, but, like, if you get that same consistency there,
yeah,
it's like, well, what the fuck am I listening to?
Yeah, so just take the time to research. There's plenty of gear for all budgets. You know, you can get mics for sub $100 or sub $70. You can get them for several $100s, depending on how far down that rabbit hole you want to go. Mm. Get yourself a little mixer. That way you can monitor and isolate everybody's mics individually, because we've all got different sounds. We've all got different volumes. So you want to make it a nice, consistent playing field across the board. We use the Behringer ZX QX1202 USB. 4 XLR inputs. It's phantom powered. So if you're using condenser mics, it'll see you through for 4 microphones or 4 speakers. But yeah, just anyone that's out there that is trying to get into that field, hit us up. More than happy to discuss and provide feedback. And if you've got anything that you've recorded that you don't want to release, we can have a listen and we'll give you some honest opinions. You know, we're not perfect. We expect to hear feedback, both good and or bad, on what we're doing. Mm. And we're more than happy to do the same.
Yeah, I got some the other day from my sister.
Yeah?
She said I can't change my nickname to STD.
That's some good feedback. I secretly wish you do, because that would be fantastic.
I will.
All right, so it is getting a bit of a long episode, but we still have to touch base with our iTunes review of the week, and then we will start going through the closing stages and get on out of here and get some lunch, because we're getting hungry. Curb, your sugar levels are dropping drastically.
Mate,
I don't see that sparkle in the eye from an hour and a half ago.
All of my levels are down. Mm. This coffee is a demon.
If only I had a sugar level Behringer Zenix beside me here that I could perk you up on, we'd be fine.
That would kill me.
That's true.
That would actually kill me.
That's true.
Why are you trying to kill Reese? What the fuck?
Because we're rival racing crews.
Reese,
I'm Forza. He's GT Gran Turismo. We're gonna race for pinks after this.
Oh, they got S2000s with spoon engines.
Anyway.
iTunes review of the week,
coming to us from William Noland, 44, from the US of A, giving us the subject line of Hungry Hungry Hippos, and it's 5 stars.
Nice.
Okay, so the review reads, host that can really talk, state facts, and have a laugh combined to make a killer show. You can hear the passion from the team in just about everything they cover, even when they dislike or disagree. Listening to this show feels like you're sitting around the table with friends chatting about your love for video games. Love this show.
Oh, thanks, man.
William Nolan, 44. Appreciate the kind words.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm glad people say that. It seems to be pretty consistent feedback where people like to listen to us argue with each other.
Yeah. You know, doubling back to the podcast nice. Discussion, our strength is clearly our banter. You know, we aren't the most technically astute. We're not the most knowledgeable on anything specific, but we can carry a conversation pretty well. Self.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's right. Reese did come out with some zingers.
I've got
today.
The know-how. I've got the personality. It's just...
You're the total package.
Handsome Reese Kirby plus two is what we're going for.
It's Reese and the cool kid.
Oh, my humility.
Cool in the gang.
But yeah, William Nolan, 44, thank you for the kind words. Thank you for taking the time to write a review and rate, subscribe, and all that. Any of you other kind souls out there feel like doing the same? We are on iTunes. We are on Stitcher. We are on SoundCloud. We're on Google Play. We're everywhere.
Please do it. Yeah, it's nice. You know, it's kind of one of the few interactions we actually have directly with people where you can give us feedback. And I listen to like a bunch of podcasts. We all do. We all listen to tons of podcasts.
Mm.
And you love podcasts. I realize there are a few that I've listened to for more than a year that I haven't reviewed. I thought that's not great. Like, I reviewed them recently because of it. And I think it's fair too, because it's, you know, without things like this, we're basically just talking at each other in a room on a Saturday.
Mm. Which is Saturday. What we would be doing anyway.
Yeah.
Which,
but now
the only difference is that we just have mics in front of us.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We'd be yelling at each other. It'd probably be a little bit more argy-bargy. But we'll try to keep it PG for you guys. Yeah.
That's been long gone.
Yeah, recent, Brennan.
We're more MA. I think we're borderline MA.
We're MA.
Yeah.
We're not PG.
No.
Nah.
Anything but.
What do you mean we're not fucking PG?
We swear a lot. Just like then. You just dropped the F-bomb in that statement.
That was the joke.
Oh.
Jesus Christ. It is a long
That's
day.
The joke.
That's the joke.
So anyway.
Thanks, William.
Thank you for the nice review. Keep them coming, fam. Keep them coming on that iTunes. We will read every single one, good and or bad or weird.
I haven't had a bad one. You watch now, that'd be a shit one.
It'll be a real bad one.
It'll be Ben or someone.
I'm still waiting.
Reese needs to shut up.
Still waiting for Mr. Two Stars to show his or her face. It's come out of the shadows.
Eating him alive. Like, Jesus, I love it.
Face me, Demigorgon. Anyway, a quick bit of housekeeping from my side. Find us as a collective at We Are 8-Bit on the Twitters, on the Facebook, on the Instagrams. Get onto our Discord chat. On YouTube at We Are 8-Bit or /We Are 8-Bit. Ton of nice content on there. The latest one we just popped up was Sam vs. Me in Until Dawn, Rush of Blood.
Which there's a huge caveat with this, which is
I feel like I kicked your ass.
I feel like I was robbed. I was robbed. It was a stupid reason to lose.
You hit your head on a wall.
Which is stupid. Like, it's stupid. It's a stupid reason to get taken out straight away.
If you hit your head on the wall with force right now, you'd be taken out.
I'll go right through it.
Oh, that's right. Because you are Hulk, remember? We've had this discussion already.
I'm just a man, but I would go right through it.
Mm.
Don't doubt it.
But yeah, check that
out.
I
just don't want to be up for damages.
And at the time of this episode dropping, there will be another Half in Form done by our boy Ben. He's played the other 99, which is like a Lord of the Flies / H1Z1 survival FPS game. Looks good. Anyone that's interested, there's that first 30 minutes dropping on the YouTubes in the next day or two. We'll have some more content. We're going to get some more Let's Plays up there. Going to do a little bit of Switch stuff this week, maybe a bit more VR stuff. Who knows? Maybe we'll end up playing that stupid Star Trek game on VR and reenacting various scenes from those shows and films.
Mm.
Can you imagine us piloting the Enterprise together?
That would just be arguments.
That thing would go down in a ball of flames.
But find me everywhere at We Are 8-Bit. Hit us up on the emails if you like. Hello@WeAre8Bit. You guys want to say anything before we start
Kerbo8Bit.
Fading this out?
At Salim Abraham.
No, sorry.
No, you're Reese 8-Bit.
Kerbo 8-Bit is, I don't know.
I think that's your Twitch handle.
Yeah, true. Not that I'm ever on there because I can't get good internet. Thanks, Australia.
Thanks, Australia.
Thanks, Turnbull.
Australia.
Fuck you, Turnbull.
What a fizzer he's been.
What a grub.
Trumbull.
Comes in here trying to, you know, change the country and this big blaze of glory, and then he just fizzes out like a wet fart.
Very political. Oddly political.
Mm.
I think that's it.
Peace out.
So, from all of us here,
much love.
And stay hungry.
Much love.
Bye.
Yeah,
I'll just let you guys have that one.
Stay hungry.
Much love.
You've been listening to The Hungry Gamers, an exclusive podcast from 8-Bit. Be sure to check out 8bit.net for all your video game and pop culture related needs. Additional Hungry Gamers episodes can be found on Stitcher, SoundCloud, and iTunes. While you're there, please be sure to rate and subscribe. Until next time, boys and girls.